All right, let's pick up chapter 10 and verses 1 and 2 basically say, don't follow. Don't look at the nations around you and do what they're doing. What they're doing is basically making up their own gods, idolatry. So 3 through 5, he talks about how the idols that they have made are impotent. They cannot do anything. They were made with human hands, cut with human hands. Don't expect them to save you. When you make up a god, when you decide how your god thinks, oh, my god loves everybody, everybody goes to heaven from my god, don't expect it to turn out the way you made it up in your mind because your hands formed it. That's what his argument is. And then he gets down to, it's interesting because he uses one of the phrases in verse 5, like a scarecrow in a cucumber field are they. Put a box around 6 and 7 because in 6 and 7 there are some really, there's a fabulous set of verses to tell you about who God is. There is none like you, O Lord. You are great, and great is your name in might. Who would not fear you, O King of the nations? Indeed, it is your due. And I would underline the word words your due. And in all the kingdoms, there is none like you. The point he's making is that not only will we not follow after the world, but we're going to focus back on who you are. And it's only right as creator that you should be the one we focus on. And then he comes back. Now, what he's doing is idols, God, idols, God. So 6 and 7, none like God. 8 and 9, idols. And he goes back to idols. They are stupid. They're foolish. The discipline of delusion. In their discipline of delusion, their idol is wood. It's interesting. People will craft what they think God is and then build an entire intricate theology around it. And there are all kinds of religious teachers out there that have created this God that isn't the God of the text, but they somehow have this elaborate theology and write books about it and have followings over it. He calls it the discipline of delusion. Get down to verse 10, put a box around 10, because that will go back to true God. So 6 and 7 are God, 8 and 9 are idols, 10 is God. The Lord is the true God. He is the living God and the everlasting King. At his wrath, the earth quakes, and the nations cannot endure his indignation. Then he drops right back in verse 11 to idols. The gods that did not make the heavens and the earth will perish from the earth. So, and then he goes right back in 12, and this is to the true God, 12 and 13. It is he who made earth, established the world, stretched out the heavens, utters his voice. So you see he's going back. It's almost like a ping pong game between idolatry on one side and the worship of the living God on the other. And then he comes down to verses 14 and 15. He's back to the idolater, not the idol now. Now he's turned his attention to the person who is worshiping the idol. He's moving now from the idol itself to the idolater, and he says, every man is stupid, devoid of knowledge. Every goldsmith is put to shame by his idols. For his molten images are deceitful. There's no breath in them. They are worthless, a work of mockery. In the time of their punishment, they will perish. So people are putting stock. The value of an idol is found in the eye of the idolater. It's not worth what people say it is. It's a piece of stone or piece of jewelry or whatever. 16 is now not about God, but now about Jacob, the worshiper, the people who worship. The portion of Jacob is not like these, for the maker of all is he. Israel is the tribe of his inheritance. The Lord of hosts is his name. So can you see how it goes back and forth? Idol, God, idolater, godly. The end of the passage, there's two pieces. 17 to 20 is all about deportation. Pick up your pack from the ground, you who dwell under siege. Behold, I am slinging out the inhabitants of the land. I'm about to shove you into deportation. And then 21 to 25, slow it down and take a close look at. 21, for the shepherds have become stupid and have not sought the Lord. Therefore, they have not prospered, and all the flock is scattered. The heartbeat of the problem God had with the people was that those who were in charge, those who were to shepherd them, did not seek him. One of the things that happens in our world is instead of seeking the God that we serve, we seek the approval of the people that we lead. There, in the heart of a leader, there is a hunger, a desire to gain approval. You must gain it from God, not from the people you lead. If you gain it from the people you lead, you will be leading by the polls. Morality will become what's popular. And the important thing is that we're called for an audience of one. God is the one who's watching. I work for one, not for many. Now, he goes on and he says, the sound of a report, behold, it comes. A commotion out of the land of the north. So he goes, here it comes. But then in verse 23, God's justification for why he judges is this. Men need discipline. They need it. A man's way is not in himself, nor is it in a man who walks to direct his steps. Correct me, O Lord, but with justice. Not with your anger, or you will bring me to nothing. God, I deserve to be crushed. That's what he says. My heart is not in my own control. But I'm asking you, correct me, just do it in love. So Jeremiah comes back and says, I get it, I'm wrong. Would you look at the end of verse 25, the end of chapter 10. Pour out your wrath on the nations that do not know you and on the families that do not call your name, for they have devoured Jacob. There is a special call that Jeremiah says, I want you to deal with us in love, and I want you to deal with the nations who have dealt harshly with us in harshness. That's very much where Jeremiah is coming from. As a Hebrew prophet, he looks at the outside world. There's the circumcised and the uncircumcised. There's the people of God and the nations, the goyim. And he says, I want you to deal with us in tenderness and deal with me in tenderness. What do you do with a passage like this? Here's what I do with it. I remind myself that all around me, we were all made to worship something. And many people make up the God in their own mind they want to worship, but I was called to worship the true God. What are the unique features of the God that I worship, the God that you worship? I would pick up in 6 and 7. I would pick up in verse 10. I would pick up in verse 12 and 13. I would pick up in verse 16, this kind of sketch of God. I would remember that God is unlike any other. I would remember, what is the term we use theologically to say over and over and over, unlike any other? What's the word? Holy. Holy doesn't mean glows in the dark and floats above the earth. It means distinct, 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 unlike any other. So I would put next to verse 6 that's a reminder of holiness. There is no other character trait of God that is used in the way, in the voices of heaven. Love, love, love. No, holy, holy, holy. That's what the angels are saying. That's unique. God is unlike, God is unlike, God is unlike. Why do you suppose so many times in the Bible it says that? Because we make God like man. We try to fashion him into an image that makes sense to us to make him like us. But his number one character trait is, I am not like you. There's nobody else like me. That's really important. The other thing is that he's worthy of my praise in verse 7. In verse 10, he's everlasting, he's alive, he's true, he's powerful. In verse 12, he's the creator, he's the stability of the earth. In verse 16, he's the maker of everything, and he is the Lord of the mighty armies. Yahweh Tsevaot, the Lord of hosts, is his name. So the power of God, the purposes of God, the person of God, all of these things are celebrated in the text. I would tell you this, that the second half deals with deportation and judgment. The first half deals with the ping pong match between whether or not God is God, or we're going to worship some other God. That's what chapter 10 is. Questions? All right, let's keep plowing then. Go to 11. The Lord reminds Judah of the consequences of breaking what's called the domicile covenant. Now, this one gets people messed up. The domicile conditions of the Mosaic Covenant. Abraham's covenant with God, or God's covenant with Abraham, I should say, in Genesis 12, 15, and 17, and 23, and 46. That covenant was an unconditional covenant because Abraham was asleep when God made it. God walked through the split animals and he walked through the blood covenant, and both sides of the agreement were God's. Moses had also, on the back of the Abrahamic covenant, a set of conditions for what is called domicile. Because the land belongs to God, and God bequeathed the land to Israel for all its generations, that wasn't on the table. What was on the table is, when are we going to get the land? Domicile means when I live there. Okay? So here's what God said. The land will always be yours. I've titled it in perpetuity to the sons of Abraham through Isaac through Jacob. It will always belong to you. And by the way, you won't be there for a lot of the time. Why? Because you won't follow me. So, if I buy the car for you and you own the car and your name is on the title, but you stay out late and I take the keys and say you don't get to drive until next week, you own the car and I've got the keys. Domicile is about whether or not you get to use the land. So, I've given you the land as part of my contract with Abraham for the sake of your fathers. And I will bless you in the land, and I will bless all nations on the earth because of you. But you won't get your land if you won't walk with me. Now look very closely at what he says. The word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, chapter 11, verse 1. Hear the words of this covenant and speak to the men of Judah and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and say to them, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, cursed is the man who does not heed the words of this covenant which I commanded your forefathers in the day that I brought them out of the land of Egypt from the iron furnace, saying, listen to my voice and do according to all that I command you, so that you shall be my people and I will be your God. He says, there was a conditional commandment when I brought them through the hot furnace of the wilderness on the way to the promised land. And by the way, there's a play there, because you know that the copper mines of Timnah down in the Sinai desert are the places where things were smelted for the Egyptians. So I brought you through the furnace of smelting, was literally the heat in the place, but also what they produced in the place. And he says, when I brought you through there, I said, listen to what I'm telling you, and I will give you what I promised you. Look at verse 5. In order to confirm the oath which I swore to your fathers to give them as a land flowing with milk and honey. Stop. The peace of the covenant I'm talking about is what makes you my unique people, but it also has the land in it. Circle land, because this is about domicile or access or living in the land. He says, part of what I told Moses was do these things and you will have the land that flows with milk and honey, and I will be your God and you'll be my people. But if you don't do these things, I'm going to put you in exile and drag you out. Verse 6, proclaim all the words of the cities of Judah. Verse 7, I solemnly warned your fathers in that day that I brought them up from the land of Egypt. Listen to my voice, verse 8, yet they did not obey nor incline their ear. They walked each one in the stubbornness of their evil heart. I brought on them all the words of this covenant. Remember that there were supposed to be spoken out of Eval and Gerizim, the blessings and the cursings. You remember that? And that Joshua fulfilled what Moses said he was to do. But remember, there was the blessings. If you follow my law, this is what will happen. But there were also the curses. If you do not, this is what will happen. And the domicile agreement hangs in that. Now you get down to verse 9, it says, a conspiracy has been found among the men of Judah. And verse 10, they've turned back their iniquity to their ancestors who refused my words. And as a result, verse 11, I am bringing disaster on them. The inhabitants of Jerusalem, verse 11, will go, cry to the gods to whom they burn incense. Verse 13, your gods are as many as your cities. He says, you turn to a different god. So I'm going to turn off the domicile agreement and cut away your right to be here. It does not take away Israel's title to the land, because that's in perpetuity. it takes away their ability to live in it. So they're going to be carted away into a place that they do not know of in Babylon. And then in verse 14, the text changes. So 1 to 13, he plays out this covenant agreement of the domicile section of the covenant. Then in verse 14, it turns. Therefore, do not pray for this people. Underline that, because that is unique in your Bible. There are very few times God says, don't pray for people. Here he says, do not pray for this people, nor lift up a cry of prayer for them. I will not listen when they call to me because of their disaster. These are verses you bring out when somebody just talks about how God's love, 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 love. He does nothing but love. He always lets everybody get off because he loves. No, the God of the Bible says, you know what? I'm not accepting a prayer on this. I'm done with this. I have a limit to what I'm going to take. And then verse 15. What right has my beloved in my house? She's done many vile deeds. Can sacrificial flesh take away from you your disaster? Don't bring me a bunch of sacrifices and start looking with the show of repentance. Now, wait a minute. If God said, don't pray and don't bring me a bunch of sacrifices, what do you want me to do? God said, in all of that, you've learned to be religious without the surrender of your heart. Here's one of the problems. You can be such a good Christian that after a while, you know how to pull off being a Christian without really being about God. You can sing the songs, you can weep the tears, hold up the Bic lighter, you know, you can do a whole nine yards. And God's not impressed because your heart's not there. Do you remember what Jesus said? This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me, he quotes from the Hebrew Scriptures. They're walking in, they got a big elaborate show going on here. Listen to me, all of you are going to be involved in ministries, and it's going to be easy for the ministry to run past the relationship with God. Because you got to keep the trains running. You got to keep, you know, we got stuff to do. So you're going to feel like, man, I need a break. I need to stop and talk to the Lord about this. You don't have time for that. We got 10 minutes and then we got another thing. And then we got another thing. And then we got this next thing. And we become overwhelmed by the program. The relationship with God is to drive the program. It's not so, the program doesn't drive the relationship with God. The relationship with God drives the program. For immature people, for people who aren't walking with God, their relationship is barely there. So they walk in and ask the church to give them one. Can you catch me up on where I ought to be on my God stuff? Because I've been on my self stuff all week. Those are the people that, you know, show up and open the Bible like they did last Sunday. And that's the only time they open it. There's no real relationship with God. He says, the Lord of hosts planted you, verse 17, and has pronounced evil against you because of the evil of the house of Israel. I'm done. And then when you get to verse 18, I want you to mark out that 18 to 23 is about the plot against Jeremiah. And it's the men of Anatot. Anatot is the town he lives in north of Jerusalem. They plot against him. But the Lord made it known to me, it says in verse 18. God tipped me off. There were some guys going to hurt me. I was like a gentle lamb led to the slaughter. You know, sometimes you just want to go, Jeremiah, come on. But I was such a nice guy. There I was, innocent as could be. I did not know that they devised plots against me. And so he turns around. O Lord of hosts, verse 20, who judges righteously, who tries the feelings of the hearts, let me see your vengeance on them. And this is where you see that the wearing of the compassion of Jeremiah gets really bitey with, well, if they're going to beat me up, God, smite them with the fleas of 1,000 camels in their armpits continually. Let them suffer. Now, that's not very Christian, you know. It's not very Jewish. It's not very believer-oriented. But you know what it is? It's a reflection that God is using the guy, warts and all, with all of this wearing of his soul. You can't be involved in prison ministry for very long, listening to people lie to you constantly, pushing really hard to find the one guy who's really giving his heart to Jesus and turning around, because there's a lot of people that are just trying to get off early, so they're just going to say whatever they got. They're going to get saved every week if they have to. They don't care. They just want to get out of there and get back to their life. It gets hard because it wears you down, and you don't have the resilience in yourself. So sometimes the lack of resilience, in my view, shows up in Jeremiah's words. Remember that the text doesn't only reflect God's view. The text can reflect exactly where the guy's at. Habakkuk, God, you're unfair. Well, he's not. It's just how you feel. And you're going to feel that, and it's okay to be honest with God about it, because part of praise is honesty. Now, it's kind of interesting because he just kind of ends with, I don't want to see them succeed, and then rolls in chapter 12 over to, Lord, you're righteous. And so I want to discuss matters of justice with you. He asks a couple of questions to God. Do you see the two questions? Mark them off in verse 1. Question number 1, put next to a number 1 next to, why has the way of the wicked prospered? And number 2, why are those who deal in treachery at ease? How come bad people are getting away with stuff, and how come you're not doing something to them? Now, you've already encountered this on many, many books of the Bible. By now, this is an old question to you. A baby Christian says, do good, get blessed. Do evil, get cursed. And then you live life a little while, you grow a little deeper in the Lord, and you know that there's an awful lot of people that got blessed that were doing wrong. And there's a lot of people who did right, like Job, who got cursed. And so then you go, wait a minute, Lord, what's that about? This is like a moving up to a new plateau for Jeremiah to understand what justice is about from the perspective of God. That's why it's in the text. Why do you have that same lesson in the Bible over and over and over and over? Because it's the one we fall back to. We keep falling back to the same question. I did what was right. Why didn't the right thing happen? You will find yourself asking that question. I did what was right, God. How come the right thing didn't happen? I was honest. How come I didn't get promoted? How come the guy who lied got promoted? Now, if you take a look closely, he's going to go back and forth between them, me, them, me. So first he starts with them. You planted, verse 2, they've taken root, they grow, they have even produced fruit. You are near to their lips, but far from their mind. That is a great line. I'd box it. You are near to their lips, but far from their mind. And that's quoted by Jesus in Matthew 15, verses 8 and 9. So put Matthew 15, 8 and 9 next to it. That's about them. Now look at verse 3. Verse 2 is about them. Verse 3 is about me. It says, you know me, O Lord, you see me, you examine my heart's attitude toward you. And then he goes back in the second half, verse 3, to them. Drag them off like sheep for a slaughter. Set them apart for a day of carnage. How long is the land to mourn? Here's what he says. He says, in the middle of the unfairness, he says, and by the way, I think chapter 12, the unfairness refers back to the plot. I think what he's talking about is the guys who plotted against him. I don't know that, but that's what it looks like to me. It seems to me that what he does that's helpful for you is in the first half of verse 3. What do you take away from this? I'm reading passages like this. How is this devotionally helpful? It is. Look what he says. God, you know me. God, you see me. God, you examine my heart's attitude toward you. The thing that secured him and stabilized him when people were plotting against him is maybe nobody else knows the truth, but God, you know the truth. Maybe everybody else thinks I'm an idiot, but God, you know you told me to say it. God, you see what's going on in my heart, and because of that, I will have confidence even when everyone else is laughing. Did you ever have that experience? Did anybody ever have that experience where other people thought you were wrong, but you knew you weren't? You knew that you were doing what God told you to do. It's hard to do right when everyone around you is laughing at you and telling you that you're wrong. The fact of the matter is that captivity was coming, and there were people that were saying that it wasn't. So not only were they plotting against him, but look at the end of verse 4. It says, because men have said he will not see our latter ending. People are saying that I'm talking about captivity, but it's not going to happen. He's never going to see it. It's never going to take place. But here's his reply is this. Alongside of verses 5 and 6 in my Bible, I have this written. You are no match for what is coming. He says, if you've run with footmen and they've tired you out, how can you compete with the horses? You haven't even seen it yet. It's going to be so powerful. This captivity is going to be so big. How in the world are you going to be able to stand up to it? You are no match for what's coming, and you have no idea how big it is. So here's his counsel about those false prophets at the end of verse 6. Do not believe them, although they say nice things to you. I'd like to hang that over televangelists. Do not believe them, although they say nice things to you. Not all of them, but certain some of them. There are some who just, they're trying to convince people that God's real tenderness is for them to grow in their wealth and prosperity. That's not God's big gig. By the way, we've got a good bit of prosperity. How's that working out? I want you to see that when you look at the second half of chapter 12, there are two things that come up. In 7 through 13, he talks about truth and what the truth is concerning what God sees of the people. I've forsaken my house, I've abandoned my inheritance, I've given the beloved of my soul into the hand of her enemies. This is what God says. This breaks my heart, but you know what? You will not play around with somebody else and still be my spouse. I will give you, you want that relationship? Take it, because you're not coming home. And then he says, verse 10, many shepherds have ruined my vineyard. They have trampled down my field. They have made my pleasant field a desolate wilderness. God uses the term shepherd for king, priest, or leader, civil authority. And so he comes back and he says, they're not leading my people the way they should. Remember, God has a different standard for leaders than he does for followers. And he picks more heavily on the leaders. That's why James says, stop being so many teachers, theirs is the greater condemnation. There's more on you if you're the teacher than if you're the student. One of the things he points out that is a key critical problem for him is in verse 12, on all the bare heights in the wilderness, destroyers have come, for a sword of the Lord is devouring from one end of the land even to the other. There is no peace for anyone. He uses the high places and bald mountains where typically they had these orgies and prostitutional rites. He uses that as a symbol of God stripping off the bare heights in taking you down and tearing you down and saying, you're not going to find peace anywhere. I'm going to strip you from it. And then he says in verses 14 to 17, a second thing. The first part up till about verse 13, having sort of given the truth about what God sees. In 14 to 17, it says, this is about concerning the wicked neighbors who strike at my inheritance in verse 14. So in up till verse 13, he's been talking about his people. In verses 14 to 17, he says, listen, I want you to understand something. I'm also going to deal not just with Judah and the Jewish people. I'm going to deal with all the neighbors that have picked on them. But there's a wonderful thing going to happen to even the neighborhood Gentiles around the Jewish people. It's in verse 13. It will come about after that I have uprooted them, I will again have compassion on them and bring them back. That's the people of God. Then, if they will really learn my ways as my people, to swear by my name, as the Lord lives, they will be built up in the midst of my people. But if they will not listen, I will uproot the nation, uproot and destroy it, declares the Lord. My people are a sampling or a show of what I'm doing before the nations. The world will know that God is God when Israel falls in line and becomes what it's supposed to be. That doesn't happen till the millennium. But what's important for us is that God is working a plan in order to bring it all about to the right place. Now, I'm going to have to move very quickly through a bunch of chapters, so I'm only going to mark out just some kind of single statements if I can, because I got to get you to a place where I know we can finish this book at least reasonably on time. And you've read it. I don't need to read it to you. But I want you to see that when you get to 13, I use the word 1 to 11 and 13 as a picture. Here's the picture. I want you to go take a belt sash, the sash that goes around that holds the kind of holds your center section together. I want you to take a belt sash and go bury it by the Euphrates River. Then I want you to dig it up, and it's going to be falling apart. And then I want to use that as a lesson. I'm going to destroy the pride of Israel, this beautiful belt sash. I'm going to destroy the pride of Israel because of your own pride. And in verse 11, as the waistband clings to the waist of a man, so I made the whole house of Israel and the whole house of Judah cling to me, declares the Lord, that they might be for me a people for renown, for praise, and for glory, but they did not listen. I made a beautiful sash to go around my center, Israel and Judah. They buried themselves in the iniquity and came back useless. Do you ever have a belt that broke? You're out somewhere, you don't have another belt, your belt just broke. How about this? You don't have a belt on, but the top button popped. Now you're kind of walking around, so you put your shirt on the outside and you're just kind of walking around, kind of, you know, trying to nonchalantly hold your pants on. The whole idea here is I made this beautiful sash and it's become worthless. I wanted the nations to look through Israel and see me. Now, in those first 11 verses, don't lose the devotional value. In today's world, you're the believer that God wants to reflect him. He wants the world to know what he's like by watching you. If you become selfish and worthless, they lose their picture. That's the idea of the first 11 verses. They lost their picture. So Israel's sin was bigger than just what Israel did. It also affected other nations. Stop there and just remember this. Justin, if you forsake God, you will therefore not only pay for that, but all the people that have looked up to and followed your testimony that fall away because of it. Every pastor that stepped out on his wife harmed dozens and scores of people in churches. As a result, he's not only guilty of his own sin, he's also guilty of theirs. Israel was guilty not just of her own sin, but also the sin of the world, because they were looking to her to be something. The guys and gals who work with you want to see you be godly. They're going to make fun of you. They're going to tell you how stupid it is, but they're hoping against hope that what you believe is real. Now, pick up verse 12, and obviously, as a result, I made you for a purpose of showing the nations, verse 12, therefore you are to speak this word to them, thus says the Lord of God to Israel, every jug is to be filled with wine. And they go, well, duh, we know what the jugs are for. That's like going to a bottling company and saying, take all of the bottles and fill them with wine. Well, we're a bottling company. We got that. That's what they said. They're like, that's the dumbest thing we've ever heard. He said, wait a minute. I'm about to fill all the inhabitants of this land, kings and priests and prophets and inhabitants, with drunkenness. Drunkenness is the state whereby you are no longer in control of your own faculties, and so is captivity. In the Bible, drunkenness and captivity are the same thing, in the sense that you're taken captive by a drink, and somehow what you thought you were saying in your mind was not coming out of your mouth. And how you thought you were driving was not what you were doing. And in your mind, it made sense, but in your body, it didn't. And for those watching, it can be hilarious, but it's usually tragic. He says in verse 14, I'll dash them against each other. This is the word for two drunks walking down a road trying to make sure that the other guy doesn't go out in the street. Boom, boom, boom. You know, they're just kind of walking along, banging into each other. I will not show pity, nor be sorry, nor have compassion, so as to not destroy them. So the rest of the passage really says, I'm going to bring down darkness in verse 16, deep darkness, end of verse 16. I want you to see that I'm going to bring it from the north in verse 20, and it's going to come strongly. And verse 22 asks the question. If you say in your heart, why have these things happened to me? Let me give you the answer in advance. If when you're going through judgment, if when tribulation comes down on you, the likes of which you cannot understand, you say, why is this happening? Just rehearse these words, middle of verse 22. Because of the magnitude of your iniquity, your skirts have been removed. He uses a play on prostitution. We've mentioned this before, this is used elsewhere in scripture, where the skirt is thrown over the person, so you see the sexual part of them, but you don't see them. He says, I'm going to do this as a matter of judgment. Throw it over them, and your skirts have been removed, your heels have been exposed. And then he says, verse 23, now he's going somewhere with that whole image. Can the Ethiopian change his skin or the leopard his spots? He says, I'm going to throw open the temptation that comes with the sexuality. Can you stop yourself? Because I don't think you can. He says, it's almost inevitable. You can't stop it. And he's talking about the lack of control that they've had in their lives. And all of that imagery is supposed to be spiritual, right? But he uses something physical to teach something spiritual. And he says, you've forgotten me, verse 25. You've trusted in the falsehood. So I myself also stripped your skirts off over your face. I put you in the position where you're completely exposed. And the lewdness of your prostitution on the hills of the field at the end. So he uses a really, really strong, immoral image to help them point out who they are. Let me just get through 14 and then I'll give you a break. In 14, he surveys a famine and he admits the iniquities on behalf of the people. There is a kind of a model of repentance. He wants to offer a model of how to repent. And the Lord tells Jeremiah not to pray for the people because the false prophets in verses 13 down to say verse 18 are being rebuked. And Jeremiah prays on behalf of the people, not those prophets, but on behalf of the other people. So what you see is verse 19 to the end of the chapter. Have you completely rejected Judah? Have you loathed Zion? Why have you stricken us so that we are beyond healing? We waited for peace, but nothing good came, and for a time of healing, but behold, terror. We know our wickedness, O Lord. The iniquity of our fathers, we have sinned against you. Do not despise us. He turns back and he says, oh God, I get it. There are people who get it. One of the tragedies of watching people walk away from God and do wrong is that the many people around them may see them doing it. They may know exactly what it is and be broken for them. But here's the thing. I can't make Josh's decisions. He's the only one who can. If he won't decide to do right, his mother will weep, I will weep, and nothing will happen. He will do what he wants to do because you know him. He's hard-headed. That's what's going to happen. And so are you. So the point of chapter 14 is I've put myself out there. I've watched the false prophets. I get it. I know what's wrong. But God, please, this is crushing us. Some of us know. I would put next to say verses 19 through 22. Some of us see it. Some of us admit it. Isn't that enough? By the way, what's the answer? No, it's not. And that's why in chapter 15, look at the title heading at the beginning of 15, supplied by the New American Standard writer. Judgment must come. It's not enough that some people in the family know dad is choosing to do wrong, because dad is still choosing to do wrong. And so judgment has to come. And as a result, sword, famine, captivity, these are all promised there. And part of what they're promised over is in verse 4. And after that, I'll let you go for a break. I will make them an object of horror among all the kingdoms of the earth because of Manasseh, the son of Hezekiah, the king of Judah, for what he did in Jerusalem. Remember that Manasseh turned his heart toward God at the end, but that was after, 53 years of sinful horror? So he says, you still have to pay for that. Even though he gave his heart back, he wounded so many people, skewed so many people's walk. If I spend my life as a pastor teaching you wrongly and at the end realize it, I might realize it and be okay with God, but all the people I taught wrongly are still believing wrong. That's what Manasseh did. And as a result, in 15, Jeremiah calls on God, asks for pardon. I love the end of 15. It ends with this. Verse 15. You know, O Lord, remember me, take notice of me, take vengeance on my persecutors. Do not, in view of your patience, take me away. Know that for your sake I endure reproach. This is him whining about himself. And then he says, your words were found and I ate them. Underline ate them. We're going to come back and see this in Ezekiel. We're going to come back and see this in the life of Jesus. We're going to come back and see this in the middle of Revelation, that when people consume the Word of God and it becomes part of them, often the imagery is, your words were found and I ate them, and your words became for me a joy and a delight in my heart. I have been called by your name, O Lord God of hosts. Put next to 15:16, Ezekiel 2:8, Revelation 10:9-10. These are other eating passages for the word. I did not sit in the circle of merrymakers. I did not exalt them. Put next to that Psalm 1. I did not sit next to the merrymakers. Blessed is the man who does not sit, stand, walk. Remember Psalm 1. Okay. Verse 18 is the title of Lamentations 1. Put a box around the first half of 18. Why has my pain been perpetual and my wound incurable, refusing to be healed? What was Lamentations 1? There's no pain like my pain. Nobody knows the troubles I see. You know, he's the only one. He's. You know what happens? When we get wounded, we tend to isolate ourselves and feel like we're the only one. That's why Elijah, 1 Kings 18, prophets of Baal, 1 Kings 19, oh God, I'm here alone, just let me die. Actually, no, I've got thousands of others, you just don't see them right now. When we're down, one of the symptoms of behavioral depression is a loneliness, or a, in Christian terms, a lone righteousness. We're the only ones who really want to serve you, God. Everybody else has forsaken you. Whenever you think that way, go to bed, get some sleep, eat right, and then talk to God, because you're off. And then here it is, 19 to 21, I put exhausted and want to quit. Did anybody ever hear themselves in their mind say something like this? If you return, then I will restore you, but before me you will stand, and if you extract the precious from the worthless, you will become my spokesman. This is God talking to him. Then I will make you to this people a fortified wall of bronze. They will fight against you, but they will not prevail over you. I will deliver you from the hand of the wicked. There's all these promises that are based on this temptation to quit. Where's the temptation to quit? It's, look at the second half of verse 18. Will you indeed be to me like a deceptive stream with water that is unreliable? God, can I trust you? That's what he says. God, can I trust you? Are you going to be there for me? Because I'm feeling like I'm alone and I'm feeling like you're not going to be there. I want to quit. He's exhausted. He wants to quit. And God adds back in the end of the passage the one thing that God adds back to each exhausted believer that comes to him. And that is, I will show up. You do not need to get better at ministry. You need to get more reliant on God and let him show up. Your best day is when he's doing it and you're not. Because when you're capable and competent and you can do it without him, then you're doing it and he'll let you, but he's not doing it. You want him to do it. So you want to go, God, I feel like I've practiced this song. I want to go out and I want to sing it to your glory. But if you don't use it in lives of people, then it's just me singing a song. Every week I say, Lord, I prepared the sermon. It's all written out. If you don't change hearts, it's not going to work. You can't do it. All I got are words on a paper. And there are weeks when I feel like I'm just droning on words from a paper.